Hey, 9 o'clock, right on time. Hello, everyone. The session is starting. First keynote, we are super pleased, guys, to welcome all of you. We already said that. And we are very pleased to welcome our first speaker, guest speaker, Ralph von Rossmannen. Ralph is the founder of Agile Strides. You may know him as a former CEO of Management 3.0. We are super pleased to welcome you, Ralph, today. I'm sure people are struggling to build successful teams, and you know about successful teams. What are the components to build a successful team? So, Ralph, welcome. The floor is yours.
Thank you. So, good morning, and it's early morning. My voice is still a bit not completely awake, but we'll manage. Welcome. Yeah, this talk is going to be about teams. So the agenda, it's a quick introduction. Then we're going to talk about 6 components that I believe will help teams to be successful. And then I want to dive a bit more into team development models. I will share a copy of the slide deck with the organizers, and I assume they will make it available for you somehow, so that will be arranged. This is me, as you can see. What I do for a living is helping teams create value. I mean, that's basically, I realized last year, that's what I do. And that's often in the agile world, the way of working, but it can be anything. But in the end, it's about helping teams. Different roles during my career, but you can check it all on my LinkedIn profile. That's not that interesting at this moment. So, art of teams. I believe that teams are the smallest entities in nowadays organizations. It's all about teams. As an individual, you can write a book, you can publish a song, or write a song, but to publish it, you need a team. And I think the problems that we face nowadays are too complex and complicated to solve alone. So it's all about teams, and it's how teams work together, how you can help teams to be successful. And I think if you are able to do that, then your organization will be successful. And if I look at teams, I believe there are 6 components that needed to create teams that can help customers. It's about clarity. It's about understanding the impact. It's about trusting one another in a team, but not just in team, also outside the team. It's engaging in conflicts. It's being reliable, act reliable as a team. And it's about caring about results. I wrote a book about it. It will be published. It's already published, available, but I will publish in the next weeks. And you can read more about it, but this is not about the book. This is just about the topics. And I want to dive into those 6 components quickly. So clarity is about who is going to do what in the team. Who will pick up which task? It's about clear accountability. And accountability in this case for me is who can make the decision that it will be okay or not okay, or what we're going to do. Who is allowed to make that decision in the team? It's about decision-making transparency, that we understand in the team, around the team, who makes the decisions and how are those decisions made, which arguments were used in that decision. It's about the skills of the team members. It's about understanding what people can do, what do they deliver to the team, what bring they with them, what kind of knowledge do they have, what kind of experience. Responsibilities, what will you do? What is your responsibility in the team? And the norms. Do we use Teams, WhatsApp to communicate? Which time do we appear in the office? Are the days that we're going back to the office altogether? Or do we work all remotely constantly? So those kind of things. And you need to have clarity about those things. And on different levels, you need to have clarity. I mean, you need to understand outside the organization, what kind of government politics are there around you? A few years ago, the privacy legislation was introduced in Europe, GDPR, and that had effect on many teams. So you need to be aware about those kind of things, legislation, competitors, workers' council, unions. What will they do? How will they influence the team? Inside the organization, but outside the team, you talk about budget, security, privacy, project milestones. Still surprised how many teams don't know what kind of milestones are there in the project or product that they're working on. And inside the team, you need to have, again, the skills of the team members. What can I expect from you? What will you deliver to the team? Expectations, how will people behave? What do we care about as a team? What are the values that we want to live up to? Team norms. and how to make decisions. And what I find important always when I read about things is, okay, nice clarity, but how do I create that? What are the tools? So the tools that you can use to create clarity in your team, and I'm not going to dive in all those tools because a lot of tools, is scenario thinking. Let's imagine that a pandemic will hit the world and they're not allowed to go to the office. If you would have done this scenario 3 years ago, you would have been prepared. So maybe the next workshop with your team can be, what if the internet would be down for 1 month? What if our company would be hijacked by hackers? Those kind of things. And there you can create clarity how we're going to act in the future if that would happen. Stakeholder mappings, impact bubbles from lean change management. Who are your stakeholders? Who do you need to please? Who do you need to consult? Value sessions. Sessions with the team where you're going to talk about what do we care about? Which values are this year important for us? You can write the user manual or ask the team to write the user manual. A lot of user manuals state clearly how to use the device, but also how not to use the device. You could write a user manual for the team, how to approach the team, how to work together with the team, and the other way around, what the team doesn't like. Team decision matrix is about 5 different models for the team to make decisions. It's about the accountability in the team. So you could use a democracy approach in some areas. Maybe in some areas, one person will make the decision because he's the expert, but there are different ways to write it down. Team competence matrix is really about what kind of knowledge do we have as team members and what kind of skills do we have on those knowledge. And the last one is team canvas or team guild. It's about, okay, start with the canvas and then write down in the middle the purpose around the values, the teams, etc. Or start small and expand it over time because maybe some areas in the team canvas you don't need yet today. So that's the things about clarity. Impact. I mean, I believe that people want to make an impact with their job. People want to understand how they change the world. Or maybe the question is about how would the world look without a team? And if you can't answer that question, then you should work on it. Because impact, understanding the impact is important. Because it will motivate you. And of course, it depends per person. But if you work for Greenpeace, for example, or some organization like that, you're really motivated to make the world a better place. And teams want to make the world a better place. That's in there. Of course, the problem is that some teams have a different perception of what is a better place. But in the end, I believe that all teams want to be good. And we all feel the need to create a social value. I mean, there's research done about it, that we have that need. We want to contribute. Plus, in the end, if you experience, if you feel that what you do benefits other people, your performance will increase. You will be more motivated, more happier, and you will deliver more, create more value. And the tools that you can use in this case are the Golden Circle, Simon Sinek, probably you know that one. Why are we doing this? What is our purpose? If you know what the purpose is, then how are we going to realize the purpose? And then the last step could be, what are we going to do? So that could be a Golden Circle session. Ikigai model from Japan. What are you good at? Because that really motivates you. What do you love doing? Important. But what does the world need? Because if you love doing it and you're really good at it, but the world doesn't need it, then you should wonder why you should spend time on it. And it should be sustainable. So what do people pay for? Because if you want to make the world a better place and you're really good at it, you love doing it and the world needs it, but you can't make any money for it, you cannot be even break even, then it's also be possible if it's difficult for you. And if you can answer that questions, and then in the middle, you'll find a hedgehog. Objective key results, pretty very popular nowadays, and they can really help you to understand the company goals and then triple down to your teams. And if you do it correctly, you can exactly see back to the top, to the highest level, OKRs, how you contribute to the company. And you can understand the impact by motivation by using the TempFox model from Mentor 3.0. So if you have that model and then you know the purpose, how does it motivate you? Does it? Or if not, then you should maybe change something. Trust. I really like this quote. Believe that somebody, something is good, sincere, honest, and won't try to harm you. I really like the definition of trust. And trust is very important. You need to have trust in different areas. I think first step is organization stakeholders need to have trust in the team. Still, a lot of organizations don't have trust in the team, put a lot of constraints, policies around the team, checks, metrics, KPIs, because they don't trust the team. The other way around is even important. And also see there sometimes a lot of challenges that the team doesn't trust the organization or stakeholders, that they believe that they want to harm them, or that they have some hidden agenda, or that they're sabotaging them even in the worst case. So this trust should be both ways. And team members should have trust in each other. And if you don't trust your team member, then it will never work. So those three are very important. And if you talk about trust, why it's important, I don't know if you ever worked in a team with no trust, but it's really creating a negative mood. It's really depressing. As I said, in a lot of organizations, if there's no trust, we're gonna implement more checks and rules because we need to make sure that's done correctly. Those rules, those checks don't come for free. So the cost will increase the organization. It will be more expensive. It will be self-fulfilling prophecy the moment you're going down this road. Because if you don't trust your people and you're going to put in checks and rules, your people will think, hey, they don't trust me, so why would I care? And if they don't care, you need to put more checks and rules in place because they will not care about it anymore, etc. Less engagement. Why would I care? I don't mind. I mean, they don't trust us anyway, so... And the last one, there's no learning. If you don't trust your team members, if you think they have something, an hidden agenda, or they want to harm you, you're not going to be open to anymore. You're not going to show how you feel. You're not going to give the feedback. So the feedback in the team is gone. With no feedback, there will be no learning. And that, again, will create a lot of issues in the team. To have trust, you need to have four components. You need to have knowledge. You need to have some basic knowledge about the topics that you're working on, the context, only the things that the team is doing. If you have some basic knowledge, and you don't need to be an expert, but if you have some basic knowledge about the topics, trust will grow easier. Consistent behavior. If you constantly change your behavior, it's very hard to trust people. It's the same what we do with trying to do with raising kids. Be consistent. If you're going to say no today, you're also going to say no tomorrow. You're not going to change behavior. The same if you're going to train dogs, for example. Good relationships. I used to have a manager that I met in the hallway in the morning, and he never said hi, never good morning. It was really hard for me to trust him in the end, because that part, the good relationship, was not there. I'm not saying you should be friends with everyone, but there should be some basic relationship, basic connection between people. And transparency. Be as open as possible, as open as allowed. Of course, you're not going to share employee files, but be as transparent in your behavior and the things why you do them to people. And that will grow trust. Again, some tools, the skills and experience matrix, team competence matrix. So what kind of knowledge do we have in the team? Objective key results to be transparent again. Feedback wrap, non-violent communication. A very strong one to give feedback in a respectful way to people. So the first step is about telling people what the facts are, what happened, what are the facts that you're going to give feedback about. And those facts, they happened in the past, they are there, people saw them, you cannot disagree with them. The next step in this one is to give your feelings about those facts. What did it do to you? And people cannot disagree with your feelings. Your feelings are your feelings. Then the third step is to say why it's so important for you. So why do you feel bad about it? Why do you feel good about it? Feedback can also be positive. And the fourth step then is to express what would you like to see changed? What did you expect? And maybe also offer help to the person. Compliments, one of the most powerful things to grow trust in the team. Just give a compliment, a real sincere compliment. And get to know your team member. There's been a lot of research, also when you talk about psychological safety from Google. And one of the things that they found out is that knowing team members, not just the LinkedIn profile, but really the people behind those LinkedIn profiles, will grow trust. It's also about those relationships. So, and there are a lot of things on the internet you can find. You can do personal maps, you can do timelines, you can do a major event in your life, drink beer if allowed, do things together, but really get to know team members behind the LinkedIn profile. For some reason, at least I do, and I know many people also, we are have problems with conflicts. We don't like conflicts, but we have conflicts every day. I had conflicts yesterday with my girlfriend about what are we going to eat? And then we talk about it, we discuss about it, not even that, and then it's resolved. So conflicts are small, and most conflicts are there every day, small, and we just resolve them in a few sentences. It's just a disagreement or a different view on the situation. And they are part of our lives. And I really like this quote, and it's again, where conflicts happen, innovation occurs, progress occurs. And we should understand that conflicts are not always about shouting, door slamming, people running out of the room. Most conflicts we just solve within seconds. But for some reason, teams often tend to wait to go to conflicts. The small ones we are okay with, but the more bigger ones, we feel very comfortable with it. Task-related conflicts. How are we going to do this work? How are we going to execute this task? And different opinions, different views on it will often create a better approach to solving that task. The second one is about process. It's more high level. How are we going to realize our vision? How are we going to realize our strategy? But having those discussions about that one or those process-related areas is good. It will help you. The last one, relational-related conflicts, are the ones that you would like to prevent in your team. That's really about culture, about how people are, and really personal conflicts about people just because they're different. And the challenge is to make sure that the task-related conflicts, process-related conflicts are handled correctly so that you don't end up with relational-related conflicts. And I think the first step with conflict is just to accept that there are conflicts. It's totally okay. We have disagreements, and we often don't even recognize that it's a conflict. Be prepared. I know teams that have conflicts, and then they conclude we should make an agreement how to deal with conflicts. The moment that you have a really strong conflict, it's hard to discuss this. So make sure that you upfront prepare a document, procedure, agreements. How do we deal with conflicts? And I think often, as I said, most teams have the best intentions, also the people in the team. So always keep in mind the goal of the team. We all want to realize the same. We just have different views on it. And I want to point out two things to help teams supporting conflicts. And the first one is the conflict manifesto. And you can change it, whatever. But the thing is, the idea is that you're going to discuss this with the team. Print it, put it on the table, put it on Miro, Mural, whatever tool you're using, and talk about it. Talk about the team about conflicts, because we often don't do, or when it's too late. But just spend 1 hour, hey guys, how do we look at conflicts? Are we afraid? What is your personal style in conflicts? Because some people, they just go in, they fight. Some people flee. So understanding how people behave in conflict and talking about it when there's not a conflict will help you when it's needed. And then you can use this approach. In the case there is conflict, and it's not just easy one that we just have tens of every day, but it escalated a bit. Then the first question is, are we all in? Because if we're not in to resolve this conflict, it will never work. So the first step, are we really committed to trying to resolve this conflict? It's a question that the Scrum Master team lead could ask. But are we all in? Okay, if so, what are the facts? Get away from the emotions. What are the facts? What really happened? What did we see happening? What did people see happening in the past? That are conflicts. Of facts, things that we can really see that happened. If you have those on the table, what is an actual conflict? Because especially when it lingers on for a few days, weeks, you sometimes even forget about what is an actual conflict? What was now the key question? Where did it go wrong? So get that also on the table. If that's clear again, what's the impact on the team and organization? Why does it hurt? What will happen if you don't resolve this conflict? And then try to find up solutions. and in the end, select the solution. And I think this one is from Sociocracy 3.0. To keep in mind, what is good enough for now, safe enough to try. It doesn't have to be a perfect solution, but which solution will bring us forward, will bring us out of the situation, it will not hurt anyone, and it's safe enough to try. We will not go bankrupt as a team or as an organization. And having this kind of agreements upfront, when there are no conflicts, talk about it, it will make it easier to resolve conflicts when they are there. Reliability. I think there are two aspects in reliability. The first one is really about you're committed, you believe in the team's goal. If you don't believe in the goal of the team, then in the value that you create, then it will be hard. So you're really committed to do your best. And you try to deliver the forecast that the team gave. And all team members. And the last one, the third one, I think is about the decisions that the team make. And I really see this happening in management teams, in those kind of teams where decisions have to be made that impact organization, teams, products, and not all people support it. So they discussed it, but in the end, they're not really supporting it. And then they go to the coffee machine and then they talk to stakeholders. We decided to go for option A, but I don't understand why. That kind of behavior is not reliable, and I think very dangerous. I think this is changing. I mean, a few years ago, I thought it was pretty bad. But for me, it's all about the forecast. And I think many years ago, the Scrum Guide talked about commitment, and now I think they talk about forecast. It's all about forecast. You cannot predict the weather. You cannot give a weather commitment. You give a weather forecast. And a forecast is a prediction or an estimate. And if you expect a team to give an exact commitment on the exact number of whatever they create, they will never deliver. Yeah, maybe sometimes. But the team is a living organism. It's not a machine. It's not always delivering exactly the same amount of value that they committed to. So it's just a forecast. The commitment is about being dedicated. And I believe that a team gives a forecast for what they're going to create, the value that they're going to create, and they are committed to deliver that forecast. I think that's how you should look at it. And if management teams are asked to give a commitment on the output, they should say, no, we're going to give you a forecast. And yes, we are definitely committed to try to realize this forecast. And if you're not reliable as a team, but also for the outside world, it creates frustration. Think about the last time that you called customer service and they promised you to call back or they promised you to resolve it and they did not do it. You're upset probably. If you're not reliable, low team performance, because if your team members don't care about what you do, why would you care? I believe that every team is connected to somehow to the organization or to other teams. You create value and this value is used by other teams or by stakeholders. If you as a team are not reliable, you're going to disrupt the flow to the organization or to the other organizations. So it's important to deliver the forecast. And again, if you're in the management team or decisions are made in the team and you don't support those decisions and you're going to talk about that you think it should be done the other way, you give a confusing message to stakeholders. What should they rely on? What should they trust? What should they think about it? That is not reliable. And it's hard because there's so much work. I mean, I don't know any organization that doesn't have too much work. It's hard to find people. So that is a challenge. The increased specialization in teams. When I started doing development 20 years ago, I could create an application alone. Database, front end, back end, it was all easy. Nowadays, you need to have different roles. And by having those different roles in the team, people are more and more specialized and it's harder to give feedback. And if I can't give feedback on the work that you do, I cannot tell you when you don't deliver your forecast because I don't understand if it's possible, yes or no. Large projects, many dependencies, makes it hard. And unclear goals. Still, so many teams don't have clear goals, don't have a clear purpose. And if you don't know that, then how do you know what to create? Peer review, feedback on each other. Feedback wrap, as we already discussed, can really help reliability, because then you can give feedback to people that, hey, we did something. I'm working out with a customer, and what they tend to do is, I'm going to deliver you Friday. And then it's Friday, nothing, Monday, nothing, Tuesday, nothing, and everybody just accepts it. So also there is about giving feedback to people. Hey, you promised me something on Friday. What happened? How can I help you to deliver? But if you're just going to accept that people don't deliver in time, it will go from bad to worse. Forecasting ranges, accept uncertainties, and constant decision-making. Also one from Sociocracy, where you can improve decision-making, make sure everyone is heard. The holy grail of teams, high-performing teams. And I really like also this quote from Richard Heckman. Good teams meet clients' expectations, and we know good teams. But great teams, high-performing teams, actively shape those expectations and then exceed them. So they're really working together with their stakeholders, customers, and then even surprise them. That's our high-performance teams. But it's not about pleasing the customer, it's also about team happiness. I think that's also a result of a team. Making sure that people develop, that people feel good about working in the team. And it's an open door, but still in many organizations, individuals don't succeed or fail, but still in many organizations, people are blamed as an individual when something goes wrong. And it's important to connect goals with results. Okay, we have that purpose, we have those OKRs, so how can we connect our daily work with those things? Retrospectives, they can really help you to improve. Stakeholder mapping. Because if you know who cares about the results, you can ask them if they care, if they're happy. Celebrate success. Because then people realize, hey, we have small wins. We're on track to make it happen. And lead by example. Just be transparent on success and failure. If something goes wrong, no problem. We're just going to learn from it. So those are the six components. Clarity, impact, trust, conflicts, reliable, and results. I want to, and it's like a garden. So you really need to support your team in doing this, and you really need to help your team. I want to talk about team development models. Does your team look like this? Probably not. It's not a machine. It's not an army of robots, androids that always exactly produce the same. I think your team looks more like this. And in this picture, nobody was hurt, so no worries. But it's chaos sometimes. It's fun. It's sometimes conflicts, sometimes struggling. Sometimes people don't like each other. Sometimes they're really productive. Sometimes they have a day off. A team is not a machine. A team is like this. And your team is maybe one tree in this jungle. It grows faster. And when there's a lot of rain in the season, it will grow even faster. And when it's dry season, it will go slower. Sometimes branches cut off. So it's a living organism. And it's constantly trying to find a balance with the weather, with the soil, with the animals. It's constantly in movement. And if your team is like that tree in the jungle or that living organism, then this one looks a bit weird because it's not always linear. It's not always growing like exactly the same amount of centimeters every year. It will depend. So maybe it's more like this. And I find it hard to catch it in a graph, but it's growing faster, growing here. Maybe sometimes the other branches will grow, but it's moving. So keeping that in mind, we know all Tuckman's model, most of us. And I hear it a lot. So my team is reforming because they just started last week or last month. My team is a storming, and that's the one that we easily use because, hey, we have some conflicts, it's not going well, so the team is a storming. And then we assume that the team will go to norming, performing, and in the end to adjourning. And this was developed by Tuckman in the 60s based on some research. But the problem or the challenge is it has never been proven in real life. There's been a lot of research, and they could not find evidence that teams always go through those different stages like this. It's more like this. Some teams go from forming directly to performing. Some teams never get out of storming. And they start by storming and they end by storming, and that's the only thing they do. Some teams go from performing back to storming. And then we all know the statement that when one team member leaves, a new team member joins, it will go back to forming. Sometimes, yeah. But sometimes teams just stay in performing or they go one step back to norming and then back to performing. So it's not like the linear model. It can always say from forming, storming, norming, performing. It really depends. It depends on the team, on the people, as with the tree, depends on the growth, the weather. There's a different view on evolution. It's called punctuated equilibrium models. And this hypothesis, difficult word for me, says an organism is stable for a long time. And then something happens. And then it adapts, it improves, it finds a new way, and then again it's stable. And this is a different way of looking at evolution than the traditional way, than the other way, when it's graduate. So for example, the temperature increases on Earth, some animals need to adapt because of this in the short term. And you can put those after each other. And then it will go up, but it will go with jumps. For example, a lot of teams, organizations will think about, let's do something with work from home. That would be a nice idea. Let's start implementing Teams and phase out Skype for Business. And then 2 years ago, COVID-19 hit the world. And within weeks, transition was done from we work in the office to work from home, where else it would have taken years. But by this external event, COVID-19, Teams was implemented in days, in weeks in some organizations, while otherwise it would have taken years. And people were like, oh, gee, it is possible to do it in short term. Why can't we do it always like that? So that is the punctuated equilibrium model. Connie Gerzik, she did research about this model, and she compared it also with teams, organizations. And she observed that a lot of organizations, teams, have this major transition, where they really make a big step, where they really improve. And in her case, was reviewing the norms, how they work together, really improve it, discuss it, and then continue again. And that often happens after the period of inertia. So after a stable period, then they really improved, and then they continued again. The more interesting was that all the teams that she looked at exactly did it halfway. Between the first time that they got together for a project and the official deadline. So I'm not saying when they deliver, but the official deadline. And it was more like, okay, so we're on track. Everybody's happy, we're a new team, we're making progress. And then, oops, we need to deliver. And we're not on track. So we need to improve. And that forced teams to improve. And that was often, in her case, when she found out, halfway. They improved, and then they moved on. So it was not that teams used the gradualism model, like going slowly, but really like stable, an event happened, a realization happened, an awareness, and then they improved. So that's nice, but university research, academic research, but what can we do with it? So you could set up your next project, your next iteration, whatever you want to call it, with a kickoff meeting. That sounds pretty familiar. So you get together, you're going to discuss how we're going to approach this task, set a deadline, and often during this session the team lead, the coach is there, gives some tips, and everybody's happy, all happy campers, I'm gonna start. Let's call it the toddler phase. That's until the first moment that they're gonna prepare for transition that they don't know yet, maybe that's coming up. But they're learning, they're developing, they're having fun, they're producing stuff, they're getting to know each other. And in this area, this phase, they're not really open for coaching. It's like, hey, we can do everything. We know all things. We are experienced. So it's more like as a manager, coach, you only need to protect them when they're necessary. Just like with kids. They just adapt. They learn. They play around. And as an adult, you just make sure that they don't hit their head. They don't run on the street. Things like that. But there will be a moment, halfway the project, and you can already schedule it then up front. Let's review what we're doing. And often in case of deadlines, they're going to realize, oops, we are not on track. We have a problem. We need help. We need to discuss things. And that's where you can, as a manager, as a coach, as a leader, step in. You can assist the team, help the team. Maybe come up with some ideas to make that transition, to improve the way of working. Then we go into the maturity phase. And the team is really open for suggestions at that point because they realize, okay, we need to have that deadline. We need to reach that deadline in time. So open for suggestions. So you can coach them. And what they did during that halfway meeting was review the way of working and probably keep on reviewing the way of working during the next phase. And then we have the closing meeting. So we finish the project, we drink beer, drink sodas, close the iteration, and we review what happened. Maybe this sounds a bit familiar because you see a lot of those meetings back in Scrum. The sprint planning is the kickoff meeting. That's where we make the plan. You see back in SAFe, a lot of teams are using nowadays organizations. Get the program increment planning event. Then at the end, we have the sprint retrospective, the closing meeting, sprint review. The only thing maybe missing in Scrum is the middle part. And if you do a sprint of 2 weeks, you could argue that maybe it's a bit not needed. But on the other hand, I also know a lot of teams that always realize in the last few days of the sprint, oh, we're not going to make it. And then you really think, seriously, didn't see this coming. So maybe that transition meeting is a big word, but maybe the first week and the first week you should do a sanity check with the team. I also know teams who are going to do a review meeting halfway the quarter to see, are we still on track for this quarter? And then let's see what we need to adapt. So that could be really helpful as add-ons to your way of working. So to conclude, we look at what teams need to be successful, clarity, having clarity about organization, clarity about teams, clarity about how to approach a team, stakeholders. They need to understand the impact. What is the purpose of the team? What is the goal? Why are they here? Trust one another. So build those personal relationships. Be consistent. Have some basic knowledge. Engage in conflicts. So don't be afraid. We have conflicts every day. But make sure that you are prepared to go into conflict when it happens. Be reliable. And it's not about delivering exactly your commitment. It's about being committed to realize your forecast. And care about results. Care about the things that you do. And then we talked about the team development model, that it's not linear. So yes, you can recognize the phases of Tuckman's model, that the team has a storming problem, but it's not said that there will be the next phase will be performing. So basically, it's about never waste a good crisis, as Churchill said. And when it happens, help the team discuss and then move to the next phase. So thank you very much for having me here, listening to me. We have some time for questions. Remarks. Not sure.
So, thank you, Ralph. Is there someone who wants to ask a question?
Or comment or disagreement, that's also okay. That also makes us learn.
Please don't hesitate to use the Q&A or the chat. No question? Maybe Ralph, you want to ask some question to the Q&A.
Oh, that's a question, yeah. So lots being said about psychological safety. It's a part of your model. It's part of trust. Psychological safety is for me about feeling the freedom to speak out in your team. Also, as Google identified it. And that's for me part of trust. So yes, it is there. And I think feeling safe in the team, being able to express your opinion, being able to make those connections, because that's also part of psychological safety, is important and it needs to be there. And one thing that I did not notice mention yet, a lot of models about teams talk about first, you need to do this first, then you need to do that. For example, Patrick Lencioni. I don't know about that. I think it's like, again, that tree, your garden. You need to look at your garden to see what it needs. And the plants in my garden probably need other different water or fertilizer than the same plant in your garden. So it's really about observing your garden, observing your team, and then seeing, okay, what does it need? And maybe some teams are totally clear about the impact. Some teams are really good in having trust. So you need to just observe your team, think about it, talk with it, and then define, okay, this is the area that I really want to work on first, because I don't believe there will always be the same order for every team. There's a question about how to handle multi-vendor and multi-geographic situations on Agile. A bit outside of this topic, and I don't think I can answer that question in a few seconds, so I'll be honest about it. My best would be try to avoid it, but that's an easy answer. But I would love to discuss this outside of the meeting, because I don't have an answer right away. Any other questions, comments?
In the chat, about conflict manifesto, do you consider a sanction in case someone doesn't respect it?
Describe the word sanctions. I think that conflict manifesto, I think, is something you're going to discuss with the team. I would say put all signatures of your team members on it, or as a team, that you're really committed to it. I think if somebody disagrees or just not respect it, you should have a talk with that person. I don't believe in sanctions. I believe in professionals. And I think you should have a discussion in the TMK. Why don't you live up to this, what we agreed on? And I think it's with everything that you agree on as a team, also the norms and the values and the work agreements. If people don't live up to them or they don't respect them, have a talk about it. Why don't you believe this? What are you not respecting what we agreed on? I think that's the way to go. I think sanctions, punishments don't work that well. I think the other way around would be better even. Compliments if people do it, things like that.
Thank you. Another question? Nobody?
Yeah, you can always reach out to me by email, by LinkedIn. If you've got any questions, comments, feedback, so feel free to do. For me, it's always an opportunity to learn and to reflect on. And I would like to thank you very much. I hope you enjoy your other sessions today. And looking forward to meet you again somewhere in a real life conference.
I want to say a great, 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 great thank you, Ralph, for your session, for this keynote. It was really interesting. I have another question in the Q&A. When is your book being published?
It is already available on Amazon, but I just want to get my own copy first before I'm going to make it announce it. So it will be in the next weeks.
Okay.
And another question, can you train individuals on being good at teaming? I think it's more about reflecting as an individual on your role in a team. I don't think you can do teaming alone. I think you do it with a team. That's a good question. Yes, you can read the book, you can do studies about teams, but in the end, you need to work together with people in the team. And it's like, if I read books about becoming a puppy trainer, I can read a lot of books, but in the end, I have to do it to be really good at it or even to experience it. I think the same with teaming. So yes, you can read books about it. You can read what your behavior is expect in the team, but in the end, you need to work together in a team to really become good at teaming and to really work as a team.
So you mean that practice is more important than the theory?
Yeah, I mean, theory is good and you need to have some theory, but in the end it's about doing it and experimenting and learning it and just doing it. So can you train individuals on becoming a teaming? No, I think you need to do it really in a team to become a good team.
Okay. No more question.
Yeah, I will share the slide deck indeed with the organizer. I assume that they will share it.
Yeah, we will share it to the attendees. I don't know exactly how, but it will be shared with them.
Okay. Now, again, thank you very much, and enjoy your day and weekend already.
thanks to you, Ralph. As I have a lot of problems with my computer, I'm not able to use sounds, but the intention is here. So really, thank you, Ralph. Have a nice day. And to all attendees, we will have a 15-minute break now, and the next session will start at 10 with, let me check, Iselin Branken for Agile Coaching, my NLP toolbox, and a workshop with Frederick
in Zoom.
Yeah, in Zoom. The workshop will be in Zoom with Frederick Galibenhuis and Adelina Stefan. It's about it's an introduction about personal agility. Once again, Ralph, thank you for this keynote. Have a great day. You can continue the day with us. And now I'm going to end this session. Right. So to everybody, you can discuss in the lounge, and we will start the next session at 10. Have a nice day.